thanks for tuning in to Magic TV. I'm the guy on the left, on the right this time, because we have a special guest today, Gerry T, fresh from Montana.
Yeah,
Montana.
It's real nice.
I think part of the strategy... I'm sorry, I forgot about this guy. with me, as always, my sidekick, LSV.
One of your two sidekicks.
One of my two today. I'm collecting them. So today, I thought we'd talk about the strategy of living in desolate, boring places in order to help you focus on magic. I think that's a great thing to...
I think I've mastered this, actually.
You started in Minnesota, that's
Minnesota,
right.
Minnesota, to Indiana, mm-hmm. to Iowa, back to Indiana, to Springfield, Missouri, now Billings, Montana.
Is that where the Simpsons are?
I think so, yeah.
Springfield.
They were down the street, you know.
See, MTV, Secret of the Pros.
Anyway, so a topic we talked about a while back was M10... Sealed. Mm-hmm. Well, limited and draft, actually.
Well, it came under a lot of fire for being supposedly, theoretically, at that time, not skill intensive.
Right, because we had a run of Grand Prix, like four Grand Prix, mm-hmm. One of which is going on right now, actually, Prague. And initially, like, I thought it was a good thing that they did M10, but myself and a lot of other people thought M10 sealed was too random, wasn't skill based enough, but that might not have actually been the case.
I think a lot of people just complain for the sake of complaining. Like, the format could have been awesome, and they're still going to baby whine about every single thing.
Yeah.
No, seriously, like, I mean, Olivier just complains and complains and complains and says he's not going to these Grand Prix, then he shows up, wins the tournament.
It's like, and then goes to the other ones.
Yeah.
Yeah, of course.
Well, he won one, so.
And he's just free-rolling now.
Yeah, at that point.
Right, and like, Martin Juza made the finals of two in a row.
Yeah.
Shingakurai also winning one of them. And, you know, that's not an accident. Like, these guys didn't just get lucky.
Well, but there's a certain point.
Clearly they know what they're doing. The results indicate that.
Well, but at a certain point, I mean, they're better players. So they're going to do well regardless. Better than certain people on this show.
Not so messed up. You don't even know Gerry that well.
I was talking about myself, Gerry. I'm sorry. You know?
Sure, man. Sure.
No, I mean, if you have a random card pool, and even if it is based on what you open... All things being equal in terms of who opens well, the better players that open
so
well.
So you're saying that, like, it's logical that pros do well at these formats?
No matter what, right?
And it was just, I mean, maybe these guys just got, you know, caught the luck of the draw that they did well multiple times.
Well, I mean, it's not quite that simple. If they open well, like, if Juza opens well in an event that where I open as well or better, he's still going to, you know, probably do better than me.
Right, but why is it those two specifically?
Yeah, I mean, back-to-back finals... Both of these guys, like, that's difficult. Like, it's hard to, you know, do that. There's a lot of people at, like, these Grand Prix.
Yeah, that's true. And especially at these Grand Prix, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, I'm just saying, I mean, there is something to that, that, you know, I know a lot of people, a lot of pros were upset because it was the notion that they're going to lose their edge because it's a less skill-intensive format, but they still have an edge. It's just not as great an edge.
Right, and what we're saying is, like, you know, with the repeat performances, maybe the edge is even smaller than we thought, or the loss was even smaller than we thought.
Yeah.
Maybe it just was still a fine format.
I don't want you including me in the Wii.
Oh,
okay. I thought that M10 was just fine. Like, I mean, it's obviously a little bit worse than all the other formats, but there's still ways to get edges, you know? Like, I mean, you're still drafting, it's still limited, like...
Well, I only played in one Grand Prix, Boston. I didn't day two. Seems pretty clear to me that M10 is all about luck.
As the result...
Says the luckiest man in Magic.
So, besides that, we're actually talking about a different tournament setting that promotes skill, and something that people weren't sure about, which is the split format at the Pro Tours.
Yeah.
Like, all the Pro Tours now are half draft, half constructed, just like, you know, Nationals and Worlds always was. And it's the first year they've done that. So far, just Kyoto and Honolulu.
Well, looking on the outside, just I mean, it's an odd thing, because being a spectator for Pro Tours, you know, for basically the life of the Pro Tour, constructed ones always seem to give you more because you got deckless, and that was always kind of more exciting, especially
right.
if you're going to F&M and grinding
and like,
out.
And like reading a match coverage of a constructed match is much better than limited, because a constructed match is a match you'll replay at some point. Like,
yeah.
You listen, you see, like, you know, Olivier playing against Juza in, like, the Tron versus Fairies, you know, whatever. That's something you would actually play against one of your friends.
Right.
Reading them play their two draft decks together, like, you're not going to have those
yeah,
decks.
Yeah,
you're not
going to
play
matter.
Against them.
Right, right. I mean, having them, and Wizards started doing this, where you get to see the pack go around the table, what the cards are, I mean, that adds a lot to it. But
that's much better than a match coverage.
Oh, absolutely. Because you, I mean, and the way you could look at everyone else's chair to see, you know, what they picked, that was awesome. But I mean, going from one to the other as pro players, how do you guys feel about him? I think that's the more that's the real question, right?
I like it, but I liked it more when it was just Nationals and Worlds. It made those events feel like more special,
mm-hmm.
and it was kind of difficult to prepare for them. Like Worlds is three different formats, Nationals is two, and like you're used to only doing one.
Right.
So having those tournaments every once in a while was pretty cool for me. You know, it's just something different. But now having to do it all the time is just kind of tiresome.
Yeah, it just makes it more difficult.
Right.
Yeah, I liked it. But I mean, I did well in Kyoto, so I might have liked it even if it was not good. Like,
sure.
I think, you know, again, more results-based thought.
For me personally, I think it's hard to, like, switch gears. Just go from constructed to limited and then, like, back to constructed.
Whenever I play one of these, whatever format I'm playing, I want to play the other one.
Yeah.
Like, when I'm done with the constructed, I'm like, yes, time to draft. Then near the second draft, I'm like, God, can I just play constructed?
See, that's probably a good thing, though.
Yeah, that I think this means it's the reason I would like them. I like switching gears.
I think it brings actually a little bit more legitimacy to each pro tour. I mean, back in the day you had like, you know, limited specialists like Gerry Wise and like that, and it was like, oh, here's a limited GP, they've done well. Oh, here's a limited pro tour, they've done well. Now you really have to be more well-rounded, it seems. Not it seems, I mean, you really do have to be more well-rounded to win a pro tour. Also, what we're talking about in terms of match coverage and being a spectator, now it's only half of every pro tour where you're not interested in the drafting stuff. I mean, there used to be just limited pro tours,
yeah.
And you'd kind of tune in and see who was doing well, but you didn't really pay attention to the match coverage. Or I'm speaking for most spectators here, I think.
I can agree that the coverage is better.
Now you always
straight
have something.
Up that their hits were just terrible for the limited.
Oh, tours. Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, and now it's like people are sitting there refreshing. One of the deck lists going up. One of the deck lists going up. You know, one of the undefeated day one decks going up. You know, and that's always going to be the case.
What we have to remember is like. We're not playing in the Pro Tour just for us or our own enjoyment. I mean, we are, but on the other hand, the Pro Tours exist for Wizards to promote their game.
Right.
And
yep.
If the limited Pro Tours weren't doing a good enough job, then it's kind of inevitable that they have to switch.
Yep, true.
I happen to like the Switch for not even that reason, which is good, but I understand what you're saying. Like, it makes it a lot harder. Like, especially since they time the Pro Tours now, so they're always right after the set comes out, because that's always the most interesting.
Yeah, you just have less. More to practice for.
Yeah, it means like Zendikar comes out, 2 weeks later we've got a Pro Tour. You need to fit in, you know, 15, 20, at least 10 drafts, I would say.
Yeah.
And then you still have to test extended, which is why testing now is good, because you get a jump on the format. But
how much is limited? I mean, to some extent, to a much greater extent, it seems, for constructed, you can kind of outsource a lot of the testing and a lot of the decisions involved with that.
Yeah, you know? Limited, you actually have to do the draft yourself.
It seems like you have to get the cards under your fingers or, you know, under your mouse, as it were.
Well, you can't test on Moto.
Oh, that's true, huh? Because it's
too soon. They time it that way.
You have to get the cards
Which
out.
I used to hate because I would always play Moto, and now I like it more because I, you know, it's...
I'm still on Moto.
Yeah.
They don't
well, I've got
a really
again
billings.
Montana.
I've got
right.
this is the hole in the pro strategy.
Thankfully, I have an internet connection. Yeah. That's about all I can ask for, I guess. At
yeah,
this point.
But yeah. I mean, I've got the Superstars Game Center here, where
that's true.
It's not that hard to get drafts together for me
yeah.
now. It used to be like much more difficult, and
really?
There I relied on Moto more. Now that I've got a group of reasonable players together,
who can actually put up with them? That's the real
yeah.
real trick.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, Luis is here. I don't feel like drafting.
Yeah. I thought that was for a different reason.
No, it's just you.
Anyway, so I think them timing the Pro Tours, yes, it makes it much more difficult. Like, especially when they have events right before. Like, I'm going to be in Melbourne a week before Austin, so hopefully
yeah.
Gerry will have a good list for me.
Hold your breath.
Yeah.
Well, I think in general, obviously from the outside, it's been a positive change. Definitely for, you know, being a merchant, it's a positive change. And like I said, I do think it brings a certain sense of legitimacy for every Pro Tour champion. Not that previous Pro Tour champions have lost a step or anything like that, but there does seem to be a sense of, like,
right.
You can't just show up with the best deck and take the crown anymore.
Right, but, like, pretty much everyone who showed up with the best deck, like, worked for it.
Yeah.
Like, which I think was fine. Like,
but
I,
now they have to balance. And,
yeah.
and it's, like we were just saying, you can outsource to get the best deck. Like,
yeah.
Maybe you're not
yeah,
going
you to play
Yeah, you
could just get a list.
Right.
Yeah.
So,
on the other hand, you're not going to have Finkel anymore. Like, you know, like Finkel showed up in one Kuala Lumpur, but he's less likely to do it for like a constructed
yeah,
Pro Tour.
Yeah, because of the mix thing.
So.
Well, thanks for stopping by, Gerry. I'm glad we got to trap you. You yeah. like that perspective on the left? It's a good spot
it's,
there.
It's okay.
A little humbling.
Tune in next week where, unfortunately, we're going to be stuck with only one sidekick. That sidekick is LSV.
See you guys next week.